Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me enormous pleasure to be here today at this very prestigious lecture. And this is the first time that I've been here to Michigan, and I must say I've been very impressed with everything I've seen so far, and especially the warm welcome and hospitality that I've received from many of the students and staff alike. Now, it was 102 years ago, the day before yesterday, that Titanic struck an iceberg in mid-Atlantic and sank, becoming the most famous ship in history. And as a passenger ship naval architect such as myself, it is such an important milestone in the history of naval architecture, the history of the social structure of Edwardian Britain and the rest of the world, that I think it's a very important and relevant story to tell. And over the 100 or so years that have passed since the Titanic sank, there have been all sorts of stories, myths, even blatant ways in which some people have tried to exploit the story for their own ends. One or two we shall talk about throughout the lecture today. But I'd like to really dedicate this lecture, as I do each time I present it, to this gentleman, because Thomas Andrews, he was the naval architect who was charged with the design and the construction of the Titanic and her three, or two rather, sister ships, the Olympic and the Britannic. And he was sailing on the ship when she foundered early in the morning on the 15th of April, 1912. But to go back to where the origins of Titanic began, we have to really go to 1889, the 1st of August, when there was a fleet review off Portsmouth, and the German Kaiser, Kaiser Wilhelm II, was present, and he visited the White Star liner Teutonic that was there with all the assembled warships of the Royal Navy. And Kaiser Wilhelm was so impressed with the Teutonic that when he went back to Germany, he told his fellow countrymen that Germany must build ships like the Teutonic and take the British on the competition to run transatlantic services across the North Atlantic. And within a very few number of years, a number of great German ships appeared that totally eclipsed the British liners. One of them, the Kaiser Wilhelm de Gross. And these ships, there were four of them, each in turn was larger than the preceding one and very much bigger, very much faster than the White Star ships and even the Cunard ships of the time. But an event happened in 1902 that would send shockwaves through the British Admiralty and the British government that would lead to far-ranging things happening in the marine world. And that was the White Star Line, which was a British company, was sold to John Pierpont Morgan's International Mercantile Marine. And in effect, it's very much like Carnival Corporation today and Cunard Line. Cunard Line is a British company based in Southampton, but it's owned by this Anglo-American, and in fact the American part is very much the dominant part. And White Star Line was exactly the same. It was a British company owned by American interests, in this case Pierpont Morgan's International Mercantile Marine. So in effect, what's not really appreciated, that Titanic, although a British ship, she was in fact American owned. And that's not really appreciated today. But the sale of White Star to this American organisation, as I say, caused a lot of consternation, and Cunard went to the British government and said, we can no longer compete with the White Star Line and the others unless you give us some help. And so the British government gave a construction loan and a very generous operating subsidy for carrying the Royal Mail to Cunard. And this enabled Cunard to place the order of two new superliners that would eclipse everything that the Germans had and certainly everything White Star had. And the keels for these two ships were laid in 1904. And they would be the great Lusitania and Mauritania that entered service in 1906 and 1907. And they were 50% bigger than the preceding German liners that we saw there. They were the fastest ships in the world. You think this is 1907, ships steamed at 26 knots. They consumed over 1,000 tons of coal every 24 hours that had to be shoveled into the furnaces by 350 stokers. It took over a week to refuel each of those ships in New York and at Liverpool, which was the British terminus at the time. And then it took several days afterwards to clean the ships because the coal dust would permeate throughout the whole ship. So a tremendous technological and physical enterprise to make these ships the largest and the most powerful, fastest ships in the world. They were the first ships to be driven by four propellers and the first large ships to be driven by the then brand new steam turbine. But they were direct drive turbines, and with the consequence of all that power, there was horrendous vibration at the aft end of the Lusitania and Mauritania. So much that when Lusitania went out on her sea trials, immediately she went back to the John Brown shipyard at Clydebank. Over a period of a number of weeks, the whole aft end of the ship had to be reconfigured and strengthened. Many of the second class public rooms in that part of the ship were completely disfigured by all the extra structure that was built into the ship in an effort to try and minimize the horrendous vibration that was at the aft end of the ship. And when you imagine these very primitive three-bladed propellers running at such high revolutions, there must have been a tremendous amount of cavitation at the aft end of those ships. But the biggest problem in operating Lusitania and Mauritania was the very high cost, and that could only be offset by the government operating subsidy for the carriage of the Royal Mail. And certainly White Star and the other lines on the continents, especially the Germans, they couldn't hope to compete with Cunard because they weren't given the generous government subsidies that Cunard had. But nonetheless, those other companies had to find a way of competing against Cunard. And it was in 1908 that Joseph Ismay, the managing director of White Star, Thomas Andrews, and John Pierpoint Morgan, collectively working together, they dreamt of a way of taking Cunard on. And what they developed was the idea of building three ships that will be half as big again as the Cunard ones, but rather than going so fast, they would go at a much more modest speed, around 21, 22 knots, that would need far less fuel, and they would be much more comfortable. And being larger ships, the economy of scale, something I mentioned yesterday, in the design of Queen Mary II, they were able to build a ship that would be able to generate the profits to compete against Cunard. But in order to do so, they had to appeal to the public imagination, just as we do today in the cruise world. Every new passenger ship needs a wow factor in order to mark its place and attract its first passengers. And in fact, Titanic and her two sister ships didn't need four funnels, but they were fitted with them because it was part of the fashion at the time. And especially for the third class passengers, the number of funnels a ship had was seen as a measure of the safety factor in the ship. So how wrong could they be there? With Titanic, the first three funnels were working and the fourth one was used just to serve the galley from one of the restaurants. Public rooms on board were well appointed, but they weren't as extensive or as grand as on the Cunard ships. Lusitania and Mauritania had great big open wells and the like that were not replicated on the Olympic and the Titanic. But what was crucial, and is crucial to this story, is that the ships fully complied with all the regulatory requirements. And in fact, in many cases, they exceeded those requirements. And in fact, what had happened was that the size of passenger ships had grown so quickly over a very short period that the rules and regulations throughout the world, not only in Great Britain, but specifically for the Titanic, we're talking about the Board of Trade regulations, they didn't keep up. And so as the ships got bigger and bigger, there were some real strange anomalies in those regulations. And one regulation stipulated that for a ship of the Titanic size, she only needed four watertight bulkheads along the length. In fact, she was built with 15. And throughout the whole story of Titanic, as I say, she did comply with all the rules and regulations. And as we will see, it was just circumstances that really led to her demise. Passengers and crew, the ships carried 860 crew. And you can see the different demarcation there between the departments. And just over 2,400 passengers spread between the three classes. And we'll have a look at the respective classes in a few moments. She was certified by her passenger ship certificate to carry 3,547 persons. But the life saving with 14 lifeboats and the collapsible boats aggregated 1,167 places. So there was 2,380 places short on the life saving. And when you look at that today, you think to yourself, how on earth could the regulatory authorities allow such a ship as that to have such a shortfall in the life saving? And the reason was that they never really expected to use the lifeboats as life-saving. They expected to use them to transfer passengers from a stricken ship to another ship that they assumed would be hailed and that was sailing nearby. So they never imagined that it would be necessary to take off all the crew and passengers and put them in the boats all at one time. They assumed the boats would be used as a shuttle service to another nearby ship. And as you can see, the Board of Trade regulations only required life saving for 962. So she carried well and above what she needed to. The first ship of the trio was the Olympic that entered service in 1911. And she was a sensation. She attracted a large number of passengers and she was renowned for her quiet and steady progress across the North Atlantic. None of the horrendous vibration and the service of the White Star Line was seen as absolutely exemplary in all the three classes, and especially in the third class, which was where the steamship lines made the majority of their profits, very much like the mass market cruise ships of today, like the Royal Caribbean and the Carnival Cruise Line ships. Now, it was the second ship, of course, of the series Titanic that we're talking about this evening. And in fact, the two ships were built side by side with about 9 months in between. They were built at the Harland & Wolff shipyard in Belfast on the traditional system of laying the keel, building up the double bottom, and then erecting frames and plating the frames. And here we see Olympic, well under construction, and Titanic nearby at the stage where the forward part of the ship has been framed. A little bit further on, and Olympic is now being readied for her launch, and Titanic has now been plated. And then yet further on, Titanic is poised on the ways and the large launching cradle up forward that would slip down the grease slipway. And the ship was launched on the 31st of May 1911 and was towed around to the fitting out berth where all the heavy items of machinery were installed prior to the passenger spaces being fully outfitted. And we see here the boilers in the boiler shop at Harland & Wolff. And the power plant for the Titanic was of a new system, a system that White Star and Harland & Wolff had developed to get the maximum efficiency from the steam. And what they did, they had two large reciprocating steam engines, in fact the largest marine reciprocating steam engines ever built, one driving each of the two main propeller shafts, port and starboard. And the exhaust from these two reciprocating engines was directed into a central direct drive steam turbine. And we see here the turbine under construction. And that power plant, as we will see, has a bearing on the loss of the Titanic. Here is the ship in the final stages of fitting out, and it was at this period that the experience of operating the Olympic on her first voyages was incorporated into the Titanic. One of the things they found on the Olympic was that it was particularly windy along the first class promenade deck when the ship was at sea. And so Titanic, at a very late stage, was fitted with an extra screen and windows placed up forward. And it's very unusual that that modification was never done subsequently to the Olympic. It was only on Titanic and on the next ship that was the Britannic. Now, in early March 1912, the Olympic had been damaged in a collision on leaving Southampton when a Royal Navy cruiser, the Hawk, as it came out of the Portsmouth dockyard, struck the aft end of the Olympic and caused serious damage. And so Olympic was sent back to Belfast for repairs. And there, for the final time, the two great sisters were together in Belfast. Now, one of the myths I would like to dispel with this lecture is that there are a few books, one in particular, that states that it wasn't the Titanic that sank, it was actually the Olympic. and there was a big conspiracy. It couldn't have been the Olympic. The reason being that the Olympic's B deck was an open promenade. On the Titanic, the deck house was extended out to the side to increase the volume of the first class passenger accommodation, and therefore the Titanic actually had a larger gross tonnage than the Olympic by virtue of this extension of the deck house side to the side of the ship. And obviously that would be something that would be absolutely impossible to do overnight or to conceal. And so any theories that it was the Olympic that sank, and as I say, there are books out there that gullible people will buy and read and assume that it was the Olympic that sank and not Titanic. Absolute poppycock, as we say in Great Britain. Now the ship, as we've said, carried three classes of passenger, first, second, and third. So let's look at the first class section of the ship. Typical of the period, the heavy woodwork. Unusually, quite a lot of carpeting, even at this stage in passenger ship interior design. Lots of areas just had wooden flooring. But one of the great things on the Titanic class, which was immortalized, of course, in James Cameron's film, was the staircase where much of the action in his film Titanic took place. And this led up through the central part of the ship, linking the first class areas. And at the top, as shown by this illustration of the period, there was a large glass dome that allowed daylight to filter down into the stairwell. And it also shows that, quite different from the photographs, the area was quite light and airy and not the dark that the photographs convey. At the bottom of the staircase was a reception area that led to the first class dining room. And of course, there are many areas of the Titanic that we wouldn't be allowed to recreate today. And the Australian gentleman, Palmer, who's trying to build a replica of Titanic, is grappling with various issues such as this, where this staircase enters directly into this public space that you're not allowed to do today. Because obviously any fire in this space is going to work its way up and compromise that escape stair. So you'd have to enclose the staircase in all sorts of fire doors, and you certainly wouldn't be allowed to have all the furniture opening out onto the stairway enclosure. But that led to the first class dining room, which was the largest public room on the ship. Again, very well depicted in Cameron's film. And for all the film's fluffery with the love story and everything else, one thing it did do, and one thing that Cameron was absolutely insistent on, was that the ship was to be as faithfully reproduced and recreated as possible. And he went to extraordinary lengths to research all the materials and the colours and everything to make the depiction as accurate as possible. So that's the first class dining room, the first class reading and writing room. And that would generally be the place where the Edwardian ladies would retire after dinner, and the menfolk would go to the first class smoking room for brandy and cigars. Now, one of Titanic's wow factors was the addition of Turkish baths. The Olympic and Titanic introduced this feature into passenger ships, and it was an immediate success. The first spa type thing at sea. And that was complemented by a swimming pool. And by today's standards, it looks very austere and plain. But to the Edwardian passengers sailing across the Atlantic, it was a tremendous novelty to be able to say that they had actually swum in the swimming pool in mid-Atlantic. Now, Olympic and Titanic weren't the first ships to install elevators between the passenger decks, because that had been done by the Lusitania and the Mauritania. But what they did do is introduce the facility to the second class for the very first time. Third class still had to rely on just stairways. Now, looking at the cabins, only a few of the first class cabins had a bathroom and toilet. The majority of the passengers had to go down the hall. Most cabins had no running water. There was a device with a sink and a receptacle that the steward or stewardess would fill up with water, and that would be used for washing, and it drained down into a receptacle beneath the wash basin. And there were separate baths and showers for men and women, and also the different classes, and of course no air conditioning, only a very rudimentary form of ventilation. And when you imagine as well, several thousand people on the ship, there was no sewage and wastewater systems that we are required to have today. Everything was pumped directly overboard. So things have changed quite a lot. But again, this is one of the areas that Mr. Palmer is grappling with the design of his new replica Titanic. So some of the first class public, or passenger cabins rather, very ornate, very, very expensive. It would cost the equivalent of something like $60,000 in today's money to cross on the top suites on the Olympic and the Titanic. Very, very expensive. But of course, it was the only way that the rich and well-heeled, and in fact, anybody could travel, because there were no aircraft crossing the Atlantic. Many of the cabins were done in individual styles, such as this one, which was done in the Georgian style. Must have been a horrendous fire risk when you think the amount of woodwork there, and of course no fire suppression systems such as sprinklers and the like. That was all very much in the future. Let's quickly look at second class. Still very grand, and in fact many of the features on board were classed as superior to second class on other ships, although, as I mentioned, Lusitania and Mauritania were, I think, even beyond what White Star did here. But very comfortable, and the second class cabin, that would be the majority of so-called middle class people. College lecturers coming over to Europe or going over to the New World to a lecture series and the like. Professional people, they would be the people that generally frequented the second class. And then finally, third class, and the very much more compact cabin. And you can see here one of these devices for washing that had to be filled up because there was not running water throughout the ship. And the third class lounge with stove enameled walls and linoleum, new wonder material on the floor that was very easy to keep clean. Contemporary illustration. And similarly, the third class dining room looks very, very austere, but to the immigrants sailing from Europe to come here to the New World. It was exceptionally clean and exceptionally well run and was very, very popular. So here we have Titanic leaving Belfast on the 2nd of April 1912. She had a very short set of sea trials that were very successful, and she immediately sailed to Southampton to prepare for a maiden voyage. But when she arrived in Southampton, there wasn't the huge publicity machine, there wasn't the interest, because that had all been done by Olympic. The Titanic slipped very gently into service without too much of a fanfare. But there was a big problem, and the big problem was that there was a national coal strike throughout the United Kingdom, and a lot of the steamships were laid up around the ports of the United Kingdom because there wasn't the coal to enable them to sail. And in fact, the only way Titanic was able to set sail on the 10th of April was by raiding coal from many of the White Star and the mercantile ships in Southampton, sending coal to Titanic. So she set off on the 10th of April 1912 at noon. She was due at Cherbourg at 7 p.m. that day after crossing the English Channel. There she would anchor and pick up some passengers. Some passengers would leave, and then she would sail overnight to Queenstown, which is Cove in Ireland, where she arrived at noon, and again she would let off some passengers and collect others that were going on to New York. So here she is in the White Star dock, a special dock built at Southampton for the great White Star liners. And it was after the First World War that the Cunard ships moved from Liverpool to Southampton, and this dock was renamed the Ocean Dock. And it's today where the Queen Mary and the other ships of Carnival UK and P&O sail from. So she's poised there. And at noon, the tugs come off and make fast on the bow to drag her away from the quay for her departure from Southampton. And as usual, large crowd of people waving off the ship as she left. And a very evocative photograph of the ship with the last link, the last line there about to be let go as the ship is eased out across the dock. But as she moved forward, a huge problem occurred. There was so much movement of the water around the ship as the ship moved forward and the ship's main propellers started running, caused a tremendous amount of suction. And as she eased out of the dock, at the head of the dock were the laid up ships that had donated their coal to her. Ships such as the Oceanic there, the City of Paris and the New York, and they were straining at their mooring lines as Titanic came out, and the mooring lines actually parted. And you see here the New York swinging round and about to collide with the Titanic. And of course the tugs that were assisting Titanic from the dock frantically ran round to try and get these errant ships under control so as to avoid an accident. And of course, had there been a collision, it's likely that Titanic sailing would have been delayed and that events that would unfold several days later would never have happened. But the tugs made fast of the errant ships and were able to drag them clear, and Titanic proceeded down Southampton Water towards the Solent and across the English Channel to Cherbourg. And this is a heavily retouched photograph of the ship at anchor at Cherbourg from one of the newspapers of the period showing what the ship must have looked like while she was at anchor. And then over to Ireland the following day, and here's the ship leaving Queenstown on her way to New York. And what everybody thought would be the last photograph of the ship as she steams down to make her passage across the North Atlantic. Now, one of my good friends who's done many of the paintings for the Queen Mary II has also done this magnificent painting of Titanic setting sail across the Atlantic for the very first time. So the situation as the ship left Queenstown was that she had 1,308 passengers, 898 crew, so 2,206 persons, with a life-saving shortfall of just over 1,000. But what's not fully appreciated is that Titanic was only sailing half full. The disaster would have been far greater had the ship been full. And the ship performed extremely well in the first few days as she sped across the Atlantic, gradually building up speed as more of the boilers were lit and the machinery started to bed in, increasing up to her normal service speed of around 22 knots. And the only problem that they had on board was that there was a small fire in one of the coal bunkers, which was a common occurrence for the steamships of the period. And so we're now poised with Destiny and Titanic's fateful story. It's now Sunday, the 14th of April, 1912, 20 minutes to midnight. And it was at that time that Frederick Fleet, in the Crow's Nest, saw an iceberg coming out of the darkness directly ahead. And he telephoned the bridge, exclaiming, "Iceberg right ahead." And immediately, a whole train of events set in place when the first officer, Officer Murdoch, ordered the helm to be put harder starboard and the engines put to stop and then full astern, and the 15 watertight doors in the lower part of the hull were closed. Now, the order was hard astarboard. And in fact, at that time, in 1912, if you ordered the helm to be put hard astarboard, what you were actually asking the ship to do would be to turn to port. It's the orders were given in the opposite sense, as if you had a tiller with a rudder. And it was subsequent to the Titanic that it was decided to change the orders to say if you went or you ordered hard to starboard, you actually wanted the ship to go to starboard. But there was some criticism, or people thought the film Titanic got it wrong with that order being given, but that was the way orders were given at the time in the opposite sense. Now, the shipbuilder, a very renowned publication in the United Kingdom, in 1911 spoke about the watertight doors and the compartmentation of the Titanic. And it said, "The captain may, by simply moving an electric switch, instantly close the doors throughout and make the vessel practically unsinkable." And of course, the press, subsequent to the demise of the ship, took that and used it very much against the ship, but they omitted in every case to print that word practically. Here are the watertight doors, and there are a number of different types. There were the main ones going through the ship, but there are also watertight doors to the coal bunkers. And these, in fact, were never very efficient because the coal dust invariably made them jam and the like. And all the great liners that had similar coal bunker and watertight doors, they always had problems with them. But Titanic and Olympic were the first ships where the bridge could automatically close the main watertight doors. And another famous ship, the Empress of Ireland, that sank in the St. Lawrence River, she didn't have that bridge control. And so when the collision occurred with the Norwegian collier and they needed to close the watertight doors, they had to be closed individually by people going down to the doors. But with Titanic, they were able to close the doors very quickly, and certainly those main doors closed, sealing off the various parts of the ship. The ship sped on for 37 seconds following the call to the wheelhouse, and she traveled just over 430 meters or 1.5 ship lengths, and the heading of the bow stayed almost constant, almost towards the end before the collision, and then it gradually began to turn, and it had swung some 22 degrees before hitting the iceberg. And the ship made contact with the iceberg for some 10 seconds, about 3 meters above the level of the keel, and damage occurred over a 90 meter, or just over 300 feet length, damaging 6 compartments in total. Now, one of the main reasons, or one of the big villains of this piece, I think, is the design of the Titanic's rudder. Because at that stage, they had not yet started using aerofoil sections. They were flat plate. And it was very much like a sailing ship rudder, as we'll see in a moment. And it was positioned directly behind that central propeller. So at least it had the thrust moving past, generated by that center propeller. But there was a fatal flaw. And that was, as soon as the order was given to stop the engines and put them in reverse, the steam automatically to the center turbine was stopped, because it only had an ahead function. There was no astern turbine, and there was an automatic valve that when those main reciprocating engines were put astern, steam to the turbine was purged. And of course, in 37 seconds, they weren't able to actually stop that center turbine, but it would have started running down, and the flow of water from the propeller across that rudder surface would not have been as great had that turbine had kept running. So here we see the flat plate rudder, one of the twin screws there, and the center propeller. Who knows what would have happened if that had still been running at its maximum power? Would the ship have moved a few more degrees around and perhaps not bumped along the side of the iceberg? Contemporary print tried to show readers in the Edwardian time just what it must have been like, the iceberg. And this was the area at the turn of the bilge where the collision occurred. And the real villain of the piece is probably this, because this is an iceberg that was in the location of where the Titanic sank, and it had a nasty red scar along the base of it, and no other ship at that period claimed to have made contact with ice. So that is likely the iceberg that sunk Titanic. Captain Smith was the most senior commander with White Star Line, and he was on his last return trip before he retired from service. And he was there to take the ship for the first round trip maiden voyage. He immediately sent his fourth officer down to do an inspection at the lower forward part of the ship. And then he sent Boxall down a second time, this time with the carpenter, to make an assessment. And Captain Smith and Thomas Andrews then went down and made their own inspection. And they rapidly concluded that the five forward compartments and the forepeak, the six compartments, were flooding. Now, Titanic could stay afloat with any two of her adjacent 16 watertight compartments flooded, and she could even stay afloat with the first five forward compartments. But with the sixth compartment breached, there was a certainty, and Thomas Andrews knew this almost from the outset, and that was Titanic would sink. Now you imagine this is the largest passenger ship in the world, the largest moving object built by man, sailing across on its maiden voyage, and it's going to sink from beneath the passengers and crew in just under 2 hours. What must have been like the realization there for Thomas Andrews and the officers that knew what would be ensuing in the next few hours? And from reports from some of the crew and officers, we can piece together how the ship progressively flooded. And of course, much is made that the watertight bulkheads were not watertight to this deck here. There was a small gap, which was nominally for ventilation purposes between the compartments. But in reality, these decks go much higher than they do on modern ships. And there's not many ships in the world that can survive with one third of their length compromised. 25 minutes after striking the iceberg, Captain Smith ordered the boats to be uncovered and passengers mustered, and they started sending out the distress call. And in fact, they started with the old distress signal, CQD, and then latterly went to the first time of using the new signal, SOS. And gradually, again, as I say, we know the way the water was entering the ship and how it progressively flooded the forward end and moved aft. And there was a paper written by two gentlemen, sadly both now deceased, but they worked at Harland and Wolff, where the Titanic was built, and using the plans of the ship in 1996, they used modern computing techniques to try and work out what the damage was and how the ship sank. And they're able to work out, I think quite amazingly, that the total damage, the accumulation of that 300 feet of damage, was just over 12 and a half square feet. But because it was spread over the 300 feet in length, that's why it had such a devastating effect. And there are various plans showing where most of the damage was assumed to have occurred as the ship bumped along the side of the iceberg. And from the paper, we can see how the ship trims with various forward damages, leading, of course, to the final situation where the ship sank. Now, there's a lot of speculation and comment about the riveting in the forward part of the ship. And the assertion is that the rivets used in the forward part of the ship were of poor quality, and when the ship struck the iceberg, that caused those rivets to shear and cause the damage. It may have been so, but I put to you, we have a ship that weighs something in the order of 49,000 tons, travelling around 22 knots, that suddenly bumps along the side of an immovable solid object such as an iceberg. I personally don't think that the rivets, being of poor quality, iron or not, would have made much difference at all. Here is the boat deck of the ship during the short time she was at Queenstown, and it's of course here that most of the drama occurred as the ship was sinking. And newspapers of the day tried graphically to show just what it was like in bringing passengers down the side of the ship. And they tried to show just how big it was by showing a building next. And the thing was that the boats were being lowered and let go, some of them with only three passengers. The reason being that the passengers did not want to leave Titanic, that they assumed that even though it had been damaged, it was this unsinkable ship. And they couldn't imagine that within a very short time it was going to completely founder. And many of the boats left, as I say, less than half full. Some only had three passengers. And one of the great films was the film made in the 1950s, A Night to Remember, that showed the difficulty in getting away the various boats and the ship sinking fast. And as the bow dipped under and the ship began to rapidly founder, most of the passengers that were still on board ended up at the aft poop deck, which was the third class area. And then there was the final plunge where the ship hung for a few seconds before taking the final plunge. Now, I've called this lecture Titanic from 1912 to 2014 because the story is still evolving. There are still things that we're finding out. In fact, a few years ago, a SNAMI, an IMARIST, and several other learned societies produced this paper about how the ship actually sank and broke in two. But apart from Cameron's film, which we'll mention in a moment, some of the most graphic illustrations, I think, are by an American artist called Ken Marshall. And these prints or pictures he painted for a book, but you can buy these prints on Ken's website that you see there at the bottom. And they really show that the marine engineers kept the electrical generators running at the aft end of the ship right up until the final moments when the ship took her last plunge. And here she is about to break in half. And the ship had sent up various distress rockets, but amazingly there was a ship less than 10 miles away, the Californian. They saw a large liner in the distance, they saw it change shape, and they thought perhaps it had sailed away. The radio operator had closed the radio down for the night, and the rockets, because they were white rockets, thought that they were a firework display because it wasn't an established procedure that if you saw rockets, it meant that there was distress. Those passengers that managed to get off the ship were collected by the Cunard liner Carpathia that was on her way from New York to the Mediterranean, and she picked up the survivors and took them back to New York. Now, the harsh reality of life at that time is shown by this payslip of a waiter, whereby his pay stopped the moment the ship sank. And the other disgraceful thing that we would say today is that most of the waiters had to buy their uniforms on credit from the White Star Line, and that the grieving relatives of the lost people were sent the bill for the uniforms from their lost partners. Now, there was a huge outpouring of emotion, obviously, and it was the first event or disaster that really ran around the world, because communications were such that news travelled around the world very, very quickly. And people at Edwardian society just couldn't believe, and all the circumstances of the different classes that had left the ship, and the predominantly it was the third class passengers that had been left behind, the circumstances of that really shook Edwardian society and made a big change thereafter. But there was a real ghoulish fascination, as there still is, with the loss of the ship, and souvenir vendors made an absolute fortune in selling souvenirs and the like to a public that was eager to collect anything Titanic. And there were a number of charitable events and memorial services. This one here in London at St. Paul's Cathedral. And there were two inquiries, one in the United Kingdom and one here in the United States. And they really were looking in the dark. They had no real evidence as to what happened. There was a lot of criticism of Captain Smith, who was driving his ship at night, where visibility was very, very low because there was very little light. But it was the practice that all the steamship companies did, and basically Captain Smith was basically just very unlucky. But one of the things would the ship had survived longer had the watertight doors been left open and the ship allowed to freely flood. And it was the paper by the two gentlemen from Harland and Wolff that were able to dispel that theory. Would the ship have survived had she hit the iceberg head on? I think she would. Other ships had rammed into icebergs and severely damaged their forward end, and they had survived. Remember, it was because that sixth compartment forward, because that had been damaged, that would cause the ship's loss. Now, although there was life-saving arrangements for 1,167, only 703 were actually saved. So over 1,500 people perished. Would more passengers have been saved had there been more lifeboats? Again, I don't think so, because they were still trying to launch those last boats and those collapsibles as the ship sunk beneath them. And I very much doubt if there had been the time to get any more boats and people off. So was Titanic substandard in any way? Well, I don't think she was. Harland and Wolff had an enviable reputation for building good ships. And when you consider that the Olympic, the Titanic sister ship, went on right into the 1930s, I don't think the Titanic was substandard in any way. And in fact, many of the arrangements on that on board were very, very sound. Now, following on from the Titanic, the third ship was originally going to be called Gigantic, and it was decided to change her name to Britannic. And she was actually completed during the First World War, and she was immediately pressed into service as a hospital ship. And she went from the United Kingdom to the Aegean, where we were involved with the Gallipoli campaign. And unfortunately, there she struck a mine. Luckily, she didn't have any wounded troops on board, but the explosion from the mine with the empty coal bunker causing the coal dust to cause an explosive cloud caused a huge explosion that ripped through much of the ship's subdivision. And like Titanic, she sank, but in fact, much more rapidly than Titanic did. And in fact, most of the people that were killed were actually killed by being in the lifeboat and being sucked into the still rotating propellers. She's still at the bottom of the Aegean, and Ballard and the like film the ship and say that it's a remarkably preserved wreck. So subsequent to the loss of Titanic, the Olympic was sent back for rebuilding with enhancements and all extra lifeboats added, the nested boats here. And she survived right up to 1935, when there was a merger of the Cunard Line and White Star to form Cunard White Star, and she was eventually scrapped at Jarrow in order to provide work for the unemployed there in the north. Now, what of my baby, Queen Mary II? What's the Titanic connection there? Well, the wreck was discovered by Robert Ballard in 1985, and then, as I said yesterday, Cameron's movie came out in 1997, and there was such an upsurge in people wanting to travel transatlantic on Queen Elizabeth II that it spurned Carnival to buy Cunard as a going concern and to invest in the new Queen Mary II. So really, Queen Mary II owes her existence to the discovery of the Titanic and Cameron's subsequent film. And of course, the great strides that we have in maritime safety since the Titanic foundered, the introduction of SOLAS that took many, many years to actually get off the ground, but it was a direct consequence of the loss of Titanic. When all the maritime nations got together, the First World War hampered progress, but it started with the first publication of SOLAS in 1929. The various areas, and today we're constantly changing and updating, making the ship safer. The deterministic probabilistic damage, or deterministic damage stability, is now been suppressed or changed to the new probabilistic method, and we have safe return to port, additional requirements that if you damage one whole section of the ship, you've got to be able to show that it can still maintain service and reach a port. And of course, there's the ice patrols and radar and everything else that's happened to make ships safer. But I'd like to finish this afternoon by telling you a story. And it's a curious story, and it's a book called Futility that was published in 1898. And it was an American author, Morgan Robertson, who wrote this book. And it was a book about a large passenger ship, 70,000 tons. So, okay, larger than Titanic, but Robertson gave his ship three propellers and a speed of about 24 knots. So not that far different from Titanic. And he set his ship sailing across the North Atlantic in an April maiden voyage. His ship didn't have enough lifeboats. And the story that unfolds in futility is how the passengers were trying to get off. And would you believe it? His ship sinks through striking an iceberg. What comes next? Well, he named his ship Titan. And it was only the white star, the nomenclature of adding IC to each of their ships, like Olympic, Teutonic, that Titan becomes Titanic. And this is 14 years before the loss of Titanic. And some enterprising person on the internet has put a plan of what he felt the Titan would look like. So that's the story of the loss of the Titanic. It's something that very nearly didn't happen. It was only because of that sixth compartment bumping along the side of the iceberg, but changed so much in the world and the way people looked at life and technology, and really set us on the path of what we have today with modern SOLAS and the way we design and build ships. And I think it's a fitting tribute to Thomas Andrews and his vision for these three great ships. For over 100 years after the loss of Titanic, we commemorate her loss and look back at everything that's been achieved since then. Thank you all very much.